Okay, let's begin. Okay, so, minutes to be approved?
The only ones I sent, and that was about half an hour ago, we had a chance to look at them, was August 16th.
They look great.
Okay, second.
Okay.
Hi.
Lynn Sibley. Lynn?
Hi.
Hi.
I'm here wearing my town clerk hat today.
I can see that.
Just wanted to update you on early voting and some changes that are taking place. Early voting is only for the November election. It starts October 24th and ends on November 4th. People can early vote by mail, or they can come in, and I will be, I'm gonna have to have a location set up in the building for early voting. I'm hoping that maybe the small conference room, I could take a part of it set up. I have to have a couple of voting booths and my auto mark machine set up throughout the early voting period. So if that would be okay with you folks. I think you'd still be able to keep the conference table in there if you had to do, have a meeting.
Does somebody have to monitor that when they're in there voting?
I will be monitoring, because they have to come to me to get their ballot, go in, and then they have to come back out and give me their ballot, so.
But nobody actually can vote?
No, it doesn't need to be.
We don't need the constable?
No, we do not. This is, we're kind of flying by the seat of our pants, because this is the first time we've done this. So being a small town, I think we can handle it just, you know, with a little bit of Mary Ellen's help, I think we can handle it for those 2 weeks. If next time, this is going to be every election. So every November election, well, every 2 years, November election. We also can designate other locations, and I'm not making that recommendation unless you folks see a reason to have another location. I'd be open during my regular business hours. However, the secretary is asking that we consider expanding to some weekend hours, and they're giving a financial incentive to do that. For smaller towns, they're asking that you be open for 3 hours, and they'll give you $250 to be open for those 3 hours. So I'm considering, there's only one weekend in between the early voting period, and I'm considering being open on that Saturday from 9 to noon. We also have to post all of our early voting hours on our website. We have to advertise, and this is not, I mean, I did add some money to my budget, but I have to advertise in the papers of general circulation in our town. So that means I have to put it in 3 papers. There is some debate on whether it will go in as just a notice or whether it would be a legal ad. I was told one time by the recorder that the only way I could guarantee that something would make the paper was if I put it in as a legal ad. And of course, we all know how expensive legal ads are. So, and plus people generally don't look at the legal ad. So if you want someone to see it, it should be in the regular news section. But I'm gonna have to talk to all the papers when it comes time to put that ad in to make sure that it will go in, has to be in twice. Once a week before the early voting, and then once during early voting, has to be advertised on our website. So that's the update on early voting. And we all, the next topic is the public records. There's quite a few changes. The new public records law goes into effect on January 1st. The main change I want to talk to you tonight about is the records access officers. The town clerk is a default records access officer. If no one else gets appointed in the town clerk is the records access officer. However, they are suggesting that you may have more than one records access officer. And due to the fact that some boards and committees keep their own minutes and keep their own records that I wouldn't have access, or even Mary Ellen would have access to, I would make a recommendation that those boards and committees, either their secretary or a member of their board be also a records, you appoint them as records access officers. I'm thinking specifically of Cynthia in the assessor's office, Valerie Bird in the Board of Health office, and Mary McCarthy, who's the planning and ZBA secretary. And the library, I guess, I haven't talked to them, the library and the school, I haven't talked to them yet on who they would recommend. Of course, the school, I don't have access to any of their records, so they're going to have to decide who's going to be the person that the towns would go to for those records.
But don't the people already send you copies of their minutes and...
We get minutes, but records access, I mean, records requests could be much more than just minutes.
So that would mean anybody wanted a request, say, for assessor's records, rather than go to you, they would go to Cynthia.
Right. And I would normally refer them to Cynthia,
right,
as it is now.
Yeah, that's what's
so,
happening now.
Right,
yeah.
Right. But they want official postings, because we also have to keep track of everyone's requests in a spreadsheet. So there does have to be one kind of contact person so that you can compile all these records requests. And that's a public record as well, so anyone can request those requests and how we acted on them at any point in time. The other changes in the law, the timing, the fee schedule, that kind of stuff doesn't really bother me too much. We do have to come up, the reason why I'm talking to you early at this point is the records access officers have to come up with some guidelines on how we would handle records requests within the town of Whately. So in order to do that, we need those people appointed. These guidelines don't have to be posted until July, so you're kind of operating for 6 months without any guidelines, but it would be good to get those started so that we kind of know what direction we're going to take as we go through this whole records, new public records law.
Would you be the person who would keep track in your Excel spreadsheet of all the requests for records to all the committees?
I would assume so, yes.
Is there any requests right now?
It goes in spurts. I mean, we get a lot of requests for like salaries and things like that. They want lists of what everyone makes.
Isn't that on the website?
No. It's in the personnel committee minutes, maybe. But that's the only place. But they want to know specifically how much everybody makes.
Yeah.
And like police officers, their salary is there on the website in the personnel committee minutes, but details, they want to know details and all that other stuff, which is not.
I'm sure.
So, yeah. So we get those kind of records requests. We get those requests probably twice a year for salaries.
Like planning board decisions.
We get a lot of planning board decisions, zoning board decision requests. You know, I get a lot of vital records requests, things like that. Valerie gets a lot of decisions that the Board of Health makes and one just general
plans.
And yeah, we get plans, and so yeah, we get quite a few requests.
Are you charging for any of this right now?
We charge, if somebody comes in, well, my vital records, I charge $5 because it's certified. So if they're just looking for a copy of a marriage intention or something like that, then it would be five cents they pay. It's hardly even worth the collecting of it. Generally, if somebody's asking for, I've been kind of cutting it off at a 10 page. If it's more than 10 pages, then I charge them. If it's a town resident, because if they're paying their taxes anyways, If it's more than 10 pages, then I'll start charging them. Oh, we get street list requests, voter list requests a lot, so.
And you charge for those?
I do charge for those.
Can anybody get them?
A voter list, yes.
Or a street list?
A street list, yes. They have to sign that they are taking a street list, so.
So all these political groups can get that?
Yep.
Information and send you all the brochures and mail it.
Exactly.
Hopefully they're party.
Now the biggest thing is they were asking for them electronically, and it's a little harder to calculate the electronic fee for one of these, you know, technically is you're only supposed to charge what it costs you to produce. So if
or
I
reproduce.
Or reproduce. So if I put it on a thumb drive for them, I usually ask them to provide the thumb drive. If they provide the thumb drive and I don't have to do anything to the record in order to put it on the thumb drive, then I don't charge. But if I have to redact information or put a record into a different electronic format in order for them to, then I would charge for my time for doing that. But now we can't charge until it reaches 2 hours worth of time in the new law. So.
Well, it works but, forward.
Yeah.
Are there any, I'm sure there are privacy issues involved with hearing out.
There are exemptions in the public records law on what you can't release.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of things within the personnel records. The salary is public.
Right.
But, like, what you have for deductions and that kind of stuff is not public.
Are the contracts public?
I think contracts are public after they've been signed.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
And of course, town employees, their salaries out there for everybody to know at any time. So town employees tend to have less privacy than the general public, so. And the other thing is dogs. Everybody's, Jonathan's favorite subject, I'm sad that he's not here.
Like ambulance reimbursements or whatever.
We don't have those anymore, so.
Yeah, right.
I have 9 unlicensed dogs right now. 2 of them are new dogs to town, so they aren't up to the $50 late fee yet. The others I'm going to send them one more last ditch effort before we go to court on them. So seven dogs, 6 dog owners.
How do you know that?
How do I get a list of untagged dogs? And I get, I know there's some dogs out there that probably aren't licensed. But if they've had rabies, I get all the rabies vaccination information from the vets. If they haven't licensed their dog, I send them a letter saying, you know, I am now aware that you have a dog and you have to license it. Sometimes the animal control officer finds dogs that haven't been licensed because they might be a problem dog and he's needed to come pick them up. If they aren't licensed, he sends them to the shelter and they have to come and get licensed before they can get the dog back out of the shelter.
If somebody moves or a dog dies, do you know that?
Usually what happens is when I send the letter saying we, you know, need, well, the census form, they can update it on there. You know, when they send out the yearly census, there's a place for the dog information. I get a lot of updates there. Then in May, when I send out the postcard reminders that you need to license your dog, they'll call me and say, I don't have the dog anymore, or the dog is moved, or the family's moved, or whatever. If I know that a family's moved, then I move their dog along with them. So, but I'm sure there's some dogs that sneak by, but generally speaking, if the vets are doing their job of providing me the information, then I'm trying to get those dogs licensed. And it's not to be mean to the public, and I know we're on TV, so it's just to make sure that dogs have their rabies and that the town is keeping track that they have their rabies. That's our responsibility. And the only other thing, which is not on the agenda, but it just came up, so it's business not anticipated, 48 hours. Just a quick notice, wanted you folks to be aware, there's an emergency management drill. It's a hazardous waste, hazardous materials drill this weekend at the elementary school. It's from 8 to 1. Just testing the hazardous materials plan that is within, it's a combined with Franklin and Hampshire counties. So just if you got any phone calls saying what in the world's going on at the school, okay, that's what's going on at the school between 8 and 1.
Good. Just back a little on the dog licenses, how many are our licenses?
I think right now I have about 350.
And there's a fee for each one of them?
Yeah.
Do we set that fee or is it?
That's set by town meeting. The new animal control law that we passed last year requires town meeting to set the dog license fees. And we changed them last year at town meeting from 5 for spayed, neutered to 10, and an unaltered dog from 10 to 15, and that was at last year's, not this last April, the April before.
Is that comparable to neighboring towns?
We're still a little low.
Is it time to rethink that?
You know, I look at it, it's certainly paying the cost to run the dog program. Those fees cover the costs. A lot of towns, there are a few local towns that are still at the 5 and 10, but most of them are closer to 15 and 20. But I don't at this point see, we changed it once. We didn't change it for 25 years. We finally upped it last year, so I don't want to quite up it again this soon.
It was an up adjustment just the last year.
Yeah. And they also get hit with the $50 late fee, which they didn't before. So it used to be $25 late fee. So now they're hit. The first late fee is a $50. There's no staged late fees anymore.
How many of them are in commission?
Oh, gosh, I don't have that right on me. But that's probably, I bet you I had 60
oh.
Late.
Oh, that's
that is. Yeah.
All right.
So, okay.
Great.
So keep in mind your records access officers for appointment.
So will you send us something?
Yeah, I can send you the list, so, of who I'd recommend, but if you, maybe Brian and I could sit down and because I'm not sure what the school's going to do. That's the biggest area, is trying to figure out who's at the school will be their records access officer. So.
Okay, good.
Okay, well, I don't see the charter school people, but Paul?
Yes.
You're on the agenda for 7:30, but we could go now.
It's up to you.
Let's go.
Sure.
Town hall use request.
I guess. I mean, you put it on there, so I don't know what it says.
Town hall use request.
Well, what happened? Do I just give you a little background? Or?
Sure.
Yeah.
So I approached the town library with using their space in the basement for a Bible study.
Okay.
And I was given a little sheet of paper. I don't know. Their policy. And so I looked at it, and it seemed fine, and then I approached the librarian, and she says, oh, well, I spoke to the board of trustees, and they says, it's religious, we don't want to do that in the basement of our library. And, also, I wanted to do it for 8 consecutive weeks. And they said that they only want to do events that are maybe, you know, one day, because it would tie up too much space in their library there. And so I called the town hall, and asked if there was any town space that would be available for that sort of thing. And so you put it on the agenda here. You know, she mentioned the old town hall possibly could be used for something like that. though I'm looking at, there's a nice space here, and I don't know if that's gonna be used for that sort of thing, you know, I don't know.
I'm looking at the town hall rental policy, I don't know about rental policies for this building. Do we have one yet?
Well, you kind of discussed it, and it never went anywhere, we kind of stalled.
Well, we do have one for the town hall.
Liability issues and stuff, I don't think we talked about.
I mean, basically, we're talking about revising the whole town building use policy.
So, it seems like the categories, and I don't think there's a problem.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
Yeah, so the categories, Whately resident, public function, there's no fee. Whately nonprofit, public function, no fee. Whately resident, private function, there is a fee, $25, well, you can.
Private function, $25, yeah.
So I don't know what you consider yourself, I mean, if you're a nonprofit, you have.
My pastor and I doing a Bible study.
What size group are you talking?
Well, this is all theoretical at this point, because I'm hosting it in my house now, but this is possibly for future use, and that's maybe at the most 20 people, you know. So I don't know, like, the room downstairs there where we used to vote, the old vote room there?
Oh, yeah, you could get 20 people in there.
Sure, yeah.
Then it'd be a question of scheduling, then there's deposit and damages, let's see, all activities require deposit listed under blah, blah, blah. So depending on what category you're in.
Well, is this a current rental policy, or is this something that you said that would, had been?
It says 1990 on the bottom.
Oh, I didn't see it.
Yeah, it's current one that hasn't been updated, and we're in the process of updating it, and we just didn't get it resolved.
I don't see anywhere where it says anything about separating church and state, so I don't think that's an issue.
There's also the Whately Church, have you talked to those folks?
Well, I haven't, but, you know, I don't know why town space wouldn't be available.
Oh, no, I agree, no, I'm just throwing out an alternative.
Well, and that was something I was gonna bring up, because at least there, you might not have to do section six, which is deposit and damages. I don't.
So, I guess, you know, the reason this was put on the agenda was you were uncertain about something.
It was an issue that I think we could have discussed, I mean, we couldn't make that decision, these guys.
Because it says here, subject to the discretion of the Board of Selectmen.
Right, they have to approve the use.
Each individual use?
Right.
Oh, okay.
Like, the snowmobile committee needs there, the Grange needs there.
Oh, I guess I wasn't.
And the Grange is semi-religious also.
It may be.
Historically, it was.
Yeah.
So I don't, you know, I don't see any problem with this. The problem might be in scheduling.
And then it would be who's gonna, not so much schedule, but who's gonna open and close the building?
Well, we can work that out.
You can work that out?
Yeah, that's not a problem.
This would be evening meeting, or?
I asked too late for this, what I'm doing right now. I was under the impression that it wasn't something that was typically done, and this was a new issue, that's.
That's true.
So, that's.
Well, it's new in as far as your specific group.
The subject matter, yeah.
Well, Bible studies, but again, I don't know what difference that makes.
You said the library said no, they weren't?
Yeah, the librarian said that she had spoken with the Board of Trustees, and they did not want religious functions, which I was a little surprised. I didn't push it, but I thought it was odd.
You turned the other cheek, so to speak. Well, I personally have threatened them with a problem.
No, I think we should have something in writing, what you're proposing, and get it to Mary Ellen or Brian.
Yeah, I don't.
Write something up of what your group is, what you're proposing, how many people.
Okay.
How many times you're looking at.
Sure.
The hours you expect. Present it to us, and then we'll act on.
I don't anticipate doing it right now, because I'm gonna host it in my house.
For how long?
For 8 weeks.
Oh, for 8 weeks, okay, so after the next session.
If I do it again, I.
Oh, all right, so if you do it.
I would have preferred to have used a neutral space.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
And I thought the library, I just assumed that they would do it. I was a little surprised that they didn't.
I
I can't speak for them.
So you guys are open as a board?
But the town is fine with it.
Yeah, I don't know how John feels, but we're two-thirds.
Two out of three is good.
Two out of three.
Open for, yeah, just like I say, present us something in writing, so we have that record.
So in the future, that's what I'll do, I'll just...
Yeah, and you have a copy of this, so...
Yep.
Decide what category you're in, A through I.
Oh, I think it's no fee section, yeah.
Yeah.
Is the organization a nonprofit?
Well, there really is no organization, it's me and my pastor getting together.
So that's not a nonprofit?
It's just us getting together and teaching about the Bible. So I, it's not like, that's it, that's all it is. It's not even his church doing it, so...
You live on River Road or what?
I do.
River Road, on the corner?
Yep, Straits Road.
So that would be Whately resident, private function, yeah, right?
That's what it sounds like, unless you're opening this to the public.
It would be open to the public, yeah, it would be, you know, the newspaper ad and all that story.
You're Whately resident, public function.
Yeah.
It looks like to me.
So...
So, okay, great.
So in the future, do I...
Submit it.
Just submit to you, and it has to come to the select board meeting, and so there's about a two-week?
Right.
Okay.
At least, yeah.
Well, that's good to know.
There you go.
All right, thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. No charter school yet, okay, maybe...
I think charter school's on for 7:30.
30.
For 7:30, yeah.
Yeah, 7:30. We're having trouble getting people. We could do new business, we could do town administrator update, we could do...
Public comment?
We could do Comcast contract negotiation. Public comment, yeah, do we have any public comments? Comments from the public, no?
Only a quick one, it sounds like the F.L. Roberts is being sold, just a matter of interest to the town.
The diner?
The whole setup.
Okay, the whole truck stop?
I heard his entire retail division, wherever else he is. October 1st, that's the story.
So somebody will take it over and will still have the same arrangement with them that we do now?
Oh, yeah, I don't know if it'll change at all the town, it has to be new owners.
Yeah, okay. Good to know. So, let's see, what do you want to do, old business?
Fall down or...
Old business.
Comcast contract negotiations, this has been on here for 3 years, huh? So I spoke with Attorney Bill Solomon, he's the cable counsel for the towns that are negotiating with Comcast.
Oh, yeah, okay.
He told me that we should receive a what is considered a final license agreement this week to review at our next board meeting.
We, and that's a product of him and Comcast?
Yes. So I'm supposed to receive that this week. I spoke with him about attending the meeting, and that was when the meeting was originally September 26th, but now it's been changed, so I'll have to follow up with him to see if he can attend, and after reviewing the agreement, I'll try to make some judgment as to whether we think he will need to attend. I don't know if you have thoughts on that or not.
Is AFCAT involved in this?
I think they're knowledgeable about the agreements, they've been involved.
They turned it over to the towns.
So they're not part of this contract, I guess?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen the agreement, and I don't have the historical knowledge to...
We also wanted to get a drop in this building.
Yes. I am told that is included, but I can confirm, I will confirm that when I see the license agreement.
Because I will say, this is a three-year negotiation, and Ryan made one call, and we hit the comment next week.
We hope.
Yeah, we hope. If past is any prediction of the future, maybe it'll be a little while, but I hope not.
Okay. Town administrator update.
Town administrator update. The trees at the elementary school have come down.
Yes, that went fast.
That was done by the highway department. The insurance company agreed to accept the town employees' labor to satisfy our deductible, which means that we can submit a claim for the cost for restoration of the screening, and we will have no out-of-pocket costs.
Right.
Because the $1,000 will have been paid through labor, in-kind labor. I'm going to be having a meeting with the superintendent, tentatively scheduled for the 26th to discuss the screening, and they tentatively made some requests to have some fencing put up to separate that area from the school. But we will see what comes of that meeting.
And you've also been talking about buying that parcel of land for future parking or future uses?
We can't talk about it at that meeting. That's going to fall under the auspices of this board as to what we want to do with that.
I guess I would like to first hear a recommendation from the school, see what they think, whether it's something they're interested in or not, before we decide.
Does the owner want to sell that land? And how much is it?
I've heard he's agreeable to that. It's 0.81 acres, and it's assessed at like $900, so it's only going to...
Not a lot of tax revenue.
No. And it's the price to buy it, I'm guessing, well, somewhere in that range, I guess, is all I can say right now. It's not a $50,000 parcel that we're buying.
So I'll include that in our...
I think I'd like to hear that decision before you actually do any kind of screening or planting, to know.
Yeah.
Since you might want to reach out to Alan before you go too far.
Well, I guess, yeah, but maybe first see what the school's interest is. If they say, no, we don't need that, don't want to bother, want the hassle of another parcel of land next to us for whatever reason, then I guess we would consider that decision before we went to the landowner.
We also might want to consider, or I want to consider the possible use of the land for solar for the school, maybe with partial Green Communities Act money, depending on what's left and, you know, what the conditions are for state grants or federal grants to do something like that.
Paul, there is a bigger parcel there that the school or town owns. I think it's like 3 acres. It's clear open that you could put solar on.
Well,
where that parking, where you can take the loop around the driveway, where people park in that open field back there. The town owns that, and even the tree, there's a tree line back there, I think.
And the kids don't use it for...
No.
Well, that's a possibility, too. But I think, you know, since we can't put collectors on the roof because of the trees in front of the school, we could put them, like Fred says, off the parking circle or maybe in...
That parcel, if you're going to do that for solar, maybe you need more parking for this additional 0.8 acre you're going to buy. If you're going to take away that parking, it's on that grass field that people park on.
Right, yeah. Okay.
So just some options. Yeah. All right, what else?
Haterville Road, Mountain Street. I got a call from Paul Dunphy from Representative Kulik's office, and Representative Kulik and Stan Rosenberg are attempting to set up a meeting with Secretary Pollock from MassDOT, hopefully for the end of September, to talk about this project.
What might the outcome of that meeting be?
The outcome, well, they could say it's not important and it's not one of our priorities, which would mean that we would continue to wait for funding. Or it could be, I'll look into it and we'll continue on. Or they could say it's a priority and we would think our chances would be better. Again, the request is for 10 or 12% of the $5.6 million that was allocated in the transportation bond bill to complete the design for the project. Because without the design, we can't get on the tip. So without getting on the tip, we're just going to keep spinning our wheels. And nothing's going to get done.
So they'd have to add a design project to the tip to fund it?
I'm not sure if the money from the transportation bond bill would have to go through the tip or not.
Well, you said construction would.
Construction. If we wanted to get federal dollars for the construction of the project,
Are the other two towns involved, invited to this meeting?
Well, the meeting that I'm speaking of is just between Senator Rosenberg and Representative Kulik at the State House.
Oh, okay.
So it's not something that the towns were going to attend.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Moving on, we had conversations with the Franklin County Regional Housing Authority about the potential for a participating in a regional housing rehabilitation CDBG grant. Well, it looks like we are not going to participate in that because we don't have anybody on the wait list and nobody responded to the outreach for funds. So if we don't have anybody on the wait list, it doesn't make a compelling argument that we need funds for a housing rehabilitation grant. So it will keep us in mind for future years.
Well, that's a good place to be.
But so that process has come to an end. As part of that process, we were working on revising the community development strategy, which is a requirement for CDBG applications. And my intent is that will continue because I've received comments from 3, 4, 5 different boards as to comments on it, community development strategy, and that remains good for 3 years. So we've already done most of the work. We may as well have it updated, bring it before the board to consider for approval, and then it will be good for 3 years. So that if it happens that there is a need 2 years from now, we don't have to go through this whole process again. Mm-hmm. And
so is there a final cutoff date for you to receive comments on that?
I think the request was September 1st. At this point, we're not shooting for any particular deadline. Okay. So if we can wait a couple more days or a week or so, would be fine. The process from here on out is we need to hold a public hearing on the revised CDS. And that could be, I think we were hoping sometime either in September or October with presenting it to the board in either October or November, sometime after that.
Okay.
And then we do have a request that the town check on the status of whether a business in town has the appropriate licenses to operate. So that's something that I'll follow up on.
Okay.
I believe there should be an email in your packet about that.
Yes, there is.
Let's see what.
The only comment I have on that is it's an agricultural business. We have other agricultural.
Yeah.
We'll stores or properties or whatever in town that are kind of well exempt from some regulations because they produce and sell their product.
Right. So, we will look at all aspects of that.
Okay. And this, they do grow some of their product there. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
That is it for town administrator updates.
Okay. New business. Agricultural restriction.
Massachusetts Department of Agricultural Resources has asked for our help in relation to this, the Edward R. Fair Trust APR. This was completed, I was told, about a year ago. And the project file, as part of the typical process, it was audited by the Natural Resources Conservation Service as part of an internal control review. And there was a newer requirement that towns sign on to the, it's really a memorandum of agreement between the Natural Resources Conservation Service and MDAR, part of Agricultural Resources, that they sign on as co-holders when the federal government provides funds for the APR. The federal government provides funds to Mass Department of Agricultural Resources. So what they've asked is that the town sign this, and it would just be the chairman signing this after we vote on it or agree to it. Um, what we're signing here is that the town is a co-holder of the restriction. And really what it comes down to is, in order for the federal funds to be released from the federal government to MDR, they need us to sign these documents. That gets to the crux of the matter.
So this will be for all APRs going forward?
I believe so. The only way the town would have any responsibility under this agreement would be if the state ceased to exist. So Mass Department of Agriculture Resources is the primary holder. Whately is the backup, really the backup holder for the restriction. So in practical terms, they need this paperwork to get paid the remaining funds from the federal government. So it's my understanding that the town will need to sign on as co-holders.
For ones that have been approved since then? I can't remember what's been in.
We may see paperwork if that hasn't been done.
Okay. So
APRs.
If the landowner defaults on this, does the town get involved?
It defaults on.
You sell the property, I guess. If they decide, well, we don't want to do this anymore.
If they don't want to follow the restriction?
Right, they want to follow the restriction.
So, town of Whately representative.
Yeah, I can fill in the rest if you just. So the Department of Agriculture Resources.
Okay, so we wouldn't be liable or be involved in negotiations or whatever if they don't follow the restriction and
right.
Go back to USDA.
It would go back to the Department of Agricultural Resources, who is the primary holder of the restriction.
Okay.
Yeah.
I make a motion that we appoint Dorothy Tozier to the Historic Commission.
Okay, second.
Okay, Darcy. Thank you, wherever you are. I'm sure she's watching.
So now they have four members or five?
They should get a full contingent.
Five? Should be five, okay.
Franklin County Solid Waste District Hazardous Waste Day MOU.
Hazardous Waste Day. This is a memorandum of understanding between the town of Whately and the Solid Waste District. The Solid Waste District to hold a Hazardous Waste Day on October 1st, 2016.
We offer the sign this one.
Yes, we have appropriated $800 for that.
Waste.
We have been asked to sign two copies.
Good, I need practice for that. Early.
In a manner of speaking.
The second. If we'll jump to the next one, because it's really on the same lines. There's an MOU for the Solid Waste District to carry out the annual inspection of the transfer station at a cost of $150. Have a pencil.
Business number C for
sessions for various issues. That's a little vague. What does this mean?
That was something that Fred wanted to talk about.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
what I'm suggesting is we have an open house information session for the public on some of the major projects that Whately is involved in right now and will be in the next couple of years. And what I'm thinking of is doing it jointly with the special town meeting, I guess, we're thinking of having in November, have special town meeting, then after that, have open discussion on several of the major projects we have going in town, like the town hall remodeling. We should get some kind of more definite plans on what that's going to look like, the cost of it. The water department merger of the two departments, they've been meeting and discussing that. I think it's time to involve the public and let them know that that's on the table and being presented and discussed. It's not final yet, but and there's the Affordable Housing Trust is another item. A few other things. I think it would be important to have an open meeting and let the public voice their concerns, ask questions, and hear about these projects well in advance before, say, the annual meeting or before any action is taken. We are proposing one on a town hall anyway, an information session sometime in either November or December. So that will happen. So it's like these other items are tagged on to that session. My thought is we would advertise it, if we can do it here on election day, tell people, you know, whatever date we pick in November for a special town meeting, either give them a flyer or even have it in a newspaper. We're going to hold a public information session. Come see what projects are being discussed in town. Share your concerns, and we'll go from there. We'll listen to people. I think it's important to do it before an annual or special town meeting because there's no commitments. We're not voting on anything, and I think people are more free to discuss and present ideas, concepts that they have, and we're not restricted by timeline to go from one warrant article to another. We're, you know, there to hear their comments. You know, we could limit discussion 15, 20 minutes, half hour on each subject if we wanted. If things get too many comments on it, and I've seen a article, even today's paper, Hadley is proposing something like that, only talking more financing and some of the department issues. It's an open forum they're proposing to let their citizens come in and hear what they have to say, what's being proposed, what funding is available.
Would you imagine having the finance committee joining us for that discussion?
If they want to present something, well, they'd be welcome to be there, I guess, if they want to answer questions, if they want to make a presentation on budget items, town funding, financing. Yeah, I guess they could.
I don't have an issue with that.
I think it's a good idea. I think we want to make sure that it is facilitated appropriately. Paul, you probably would be the chair and be the facilitator of the event. As the chair of the select board, but I think it's a good idea. I would like to see us really do a good job of marketing, okay. So that it's not just an announcement, but it's a real effort to maximize exposure, so we maximize the number of people who take advantage right. of the opportunity.
I wholeheartedly agree with you, and that's why I think maybe an election day having some kind of display or announcement that's going to happen. Plus, they talk to the reporter the week before or two to write an article about it. Well, that and about the special town meeting, probably.
Yeah, and other marketing avenues.
Yeah.
Beyond that, but
well,
yeah.
Right.
But as long as it's run, we don't want a free for all, obviously.
No.
But I think it's a great idea because we
have some control either by the chair or right. the town moderator if we decide to involve him, but.
Sure.
And to do it in joint with the special town meeting, I assume we're going to have. So at least you may get more people at a special town meeting. Maybe not, but you don't know. If we don't get any more of this kind of event, well, then We'll learn from that, I guess.
Well, I think it's a good idea, and I would nominate Fred to be the motive force both behind organizing for it, and I'd certainly be happy to attend and chair if that's...
I think the Rich idea is something we should at least talk about.
The which?
Having the moderator facilitate.
Sure.
Well, he will at least facilitate a special meeting.
Well, of course he would, right. I understand that, right. But having him facilitate a discussion.
Why not?
Okay, and yeah, I'd be glad to, I guess, be a lead in this. I would also like Brian's help, is that okay?
That's fine with me.
With scheduling and coordinating and talking to Mary Ellen with the school and making sure it's available, whatever.
That's great.
Right. And let's think about, let's make sure that we... that we're smart about agenda items that we want to make sure are covered. You mentioned Town Hall Emeritus and the water merger. There may be one other. I mean, but let's be smart about what else, and then also, yes, be smart about 15 minutes of conversation.
Right.
Because we're gonna lose people if it goes too long.
Right,
so.
Right. So, well, then if any of you have suggestions for topics of presentations,
well, I can think of one.
Share them with me or Brian, I guess, if you want.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right.
Do we have a special time meeting date yet?
No.
But is that an accurate statement of Fred's that we might have one?
Yes. We should anticipate on having one.
Okay. Let's not compete with Thanksgiving.
That's good.
Okay. So,
I like to state the obvious. That's why I said that.
That's good.
And that's one of the agenda items I want on the next meeting is that I'm starting to pile a list of items that will probably need special time meeting approval. So
okay.
We can discuss those.
All right, so let's move on. The agenda lists topics reasonably yada yada yada.
Shane, here, Shane.
Yes, hi.
Hi, I'm Mary Ellen.
Hi, Mary Ellen. Good to find
come up front.
Nice to probably have a friend here too.
Okay,
that's
fine.
Awesome. Just stay in the middle. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Do you want to go right here?
Sure. So, you are?
Yes. Hi, my name is Shane Dunn. I am here from the Great Schools of Massachusetts, Yes on Two campaign. Do you want me to just go right into the whole spiel, or do you want anything else?
Well, we're familiar with
your background.
Please.
A month ago, was it two meetings ago, a representative from the Massachusetts Teachers Association came to voice their opposition to question, ballot question two. And we and she had asked us to sign or pass a resolution of some kind. And I had said, and Fred agreed that, you know, it's the board's norm to hear both sides of an issue before we passed anything. And we normally didn't hear about something and vote on something that night anyway. And so we all agreed that we would invite the other side of the debate because it's an important debate and both sides have very valid concerns. We would invite the other side and...
That's fine.
That's Shane.
Here you are.
Every time I hear the other side, though, I always feel like, was there only two sides to this debate? Or are there three or four?
Sure.
That fence sometimes is a very comfortable space to be.
Yeah.
Right?
Education is not going to be black or white, that's for sure.
That's right. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well.
Good. And then Amanda, you want to say who you are, Amanda?
Yeah. My name's Amanda Gothier, and I am from Chicopee originally. I taught in Phoenix, Arizona, and then at Excel Academy, which is where I worked with James, the charter school in Boston, and moved back to Springfield to open Springfield Prep Charter School last year. And then currently this year I'm working for the Springfield Public Schools in the Empowerment Zone, where we're working to kind of reset some of the middle schools in Springfield.
Can you spell your last name for me for the record?
G-A-U-T-H-I-E-R.
Thank you.
Just as an aside, what charter school were you in?
I was actually in a district school.
Oh, you were in district school?
Yeah. Yep. So.
Great. So you've taught in both areas?
Yes. Yeah.
Which is part of what this is all about, again.
Yeah.
Charter schools are public schools, and district schools obviously have been around for a long time, and so teachers can go back and forth and definitely have an impact in a variety of communities across the country. So I'll give a couple minute overview. Amanda will definitely add her piece as having taught in charter schools as well as in district schools, and then we're of course open to questions from you all as well as the audience. But first, thank you for inviting us, Jonathan, for reaching out, Mary Ellen, for connecting with me. Very much appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Like I said, my name is Shane Dunn. I'm from the Yes on Two campaign. Prior to joining this campaign over the summer, I did work at Excel Academy Charter School, which is a high-performing charter school in East Boston and Chelsea, serving a primarily low-income Latino community. And you know, when I drove through Whately today, you know, I did come in from Boston for this, which I was excited to do. It looks very similar to the place I grew up. I'm from rural upstate New York, a town from about 1,600 people. You know, there are more farms and cows and horses than there were people in many respect, in one regional district school, which I was fortunate enough to go to, and then, you know, led me on a path to, you know, which I consider success for me today, to work in a strong professional environment in a great city. But I'm here today, of course, again, to talk about two things: educational choice and opportunity for families. And I very strongly believe that families deserve an opportunity to send their kids wherever they see fit. And importantly, for a lot of families, that should be a public school. And charter schools are public schools of choice for a lot of families in this Commonwealth and around the country. We here at the Yes on Two campaign are trying to provide more choice and more opportunities for more families. Massachusetts charter schools are among the best in the country. I don't know if everyone is aware of that, but I think it's worth sharing. We do have the best public school public school system in the country across the Commonwealth. You know, our district schools are great in most communities across the state. However, there's really big diverging achievement and opportunity gaps. Kids from, you know, low-income backgrounds, for example, are about, you know, 25 to 30 points behind on state exams and SAT scores and graduation requirements compared to their wealthier white peers. I think that is wrong, for sure. And I think some charter schools and other district schools are doing everything they can to close those gaps. So, you know, like I said, charter schools are public schools. You know, there's a lot of myths out there. You know, the other side may have tried to pretend that charter schools are private schools, but it is not the case. Taxpayer dollars pay for students to attend charter schools. Money follows students wherever they go in this Commonwealth when they go to public schools. So if a student leaves a district school because they choose to go to a charter school and they get in, taxpayer dollars follow that student and pays for, you know, that school to be able to educate them. So I think it's very important just to recognize that charter schools, again, are public schools. They are not private schools. The final thing I do want to mention is, again, the reason this is on the ballot this fall and why we've been debating this question for a few years now in the legislature is there are a lot of families trying to get into charter schools. There's over 32,000 students of all ages on charter school wait lists across the Commonwealth. I know when I worked at Excel Academy, over 500 students were left on waiting lists for three small middle schools in Boston and in Chelsea. These are families whose options, alternatives, were unfortunately not that good. They were dropout factories, essentially, and they were not gonna go on to college like their families had hoped they would. Instead, they're gonna be stuck in failing schools where they might be unsafe, and they may, again, not go to college if that's the path that they wanted to be on. There are 32,000 families across this Commonwealth, primarily in urban areas, with those schools, and they're trying to get into new charter schools. So we are here, the Great Schools Massachusetts team is here, trying to lift this cap. This cap exists, again, primarily in low-income areas where we have met the cap, where there's this great demand, but there are no seats left. And across the Commonwealth, there actually still are seats available in, you know, wealthier communities that actually do not want or need charter schools. This cap lift will not really affect those schools because parents may not want them. If a community does not want a charter school, charter schools don't have to open. This cap lift will do three things. This cap lift will provide up to 12 new charter schools or expansions per year, up to, again, it is up to the state board to approve these charter school applications and up to the communities to welcome them. Second, if there are that many applications annually, the preference and priority will always be given to the lowest performing districts. So for example, Boston or Holyoke, you know, they will be given preference over any other community in the Commonwealth for good reason, because those communities do not have great public schools, whereas the Newtons, Wellesleys of the world, at least in the suburban parts of Boston, have great public schools. They're not gonna be given preference. Importantly, the reason charter schools are, one of the reasons charter schools are so strong here in Massachusetts, the State Board of Education and DESE, the department, are extremely strong, thoughtful authorizers. They don't let much through. And those regulatory systems will remain in place and probably get even tougher, because with more applications and more opportunity comes an, you know, chance that we will dilute our education system, and no one here in the Commonwealth wants that to happen. The final point to say is that, you know, with these up to 12 schools, we can never have more charter school seats than 1% of the total enrollment of students in public schools annually. So that is meant to, again, to cap the actual numbers of new seats going into charter schools to maintain, again, you know, traditional public school districts need to maintain most of the students for sure. Whereas, again, charter schools are providing this option and this opportunity for other families. So just, you know, in closing, before I turn it over to Amanda, you know, I've been to charter schools across the state now. I've been to district schools across the state now in this role, as well as working at Excel Academy. And it breaks my heart, and I would expect anyone in this room, it breaks your heart to see a family crying on lottery night at a charter school, which Amanda has definitely experienced, as have I, to know that they're not going to be able to go to a school that's going to provide their child to reach the potential that they are inherently born with. And that happens, again, in communities across the Commonwealth. It is unfortunately very stark in certain communities in this state. We are not an equal Commonwealth right now when it comes to education. We do want to provide. We're not going to fix that overnight with charter schools. Charter schools haven't even fixed it, but they've done a pretty good job in a lot of the communities where they are flourishing, including, again, Boston, even out here in Springfield, for sure. Amanda's worked in other, you know, primarily low-income communities where, you know, nothing more than a parent's voice is what is trying to make this movement work. And we're pushing forward, and that's why we are asking for your support for ESM2, but anyone else who's watching out there. And so we are going to be pushing for the next 55 days to ensure you know, more charter schools are allowed in this state in the lowest performing districts. So I'm happy to take questions in a minute, but I definitely want Amanda to share her experience as a teacher.
So I taught out in a district school in Glendale, Arizona, right outside Phoenix. And it was Teach for America, so I was only there for 2 years. But was very disheartened at the end of my 2 years. It's really tough to go into a school every day that you see failing kids. This was a school where the students were not performing highly on state exams. And so by the time they were getting out of middle school and going into high school, they were not prepared at all to graduate high school. And even if they made it through high school, they weren't going to be prepared for college. And so that was really tough to see. Moved back to Boston, got a job at Excel, and was like incredibly amazed at what can be done, even for low-income students, when the right systems and structures aren't in place. And I think, you know, coming from, my mother's a teacher, she's taught in public education, Springfield, East Long Meadow now, her whole life, and I hold nothing against public school teachers. I'm a product of, you know, or district schools. I'm a product of district schools. I went to Chicopee Public Schools. And I think there's good people working everywhere, but I think there's a lot of flaws in some of our bigger districts that serve low-income students. And so it's really exciting for me, both at Excel in Boston and coming into Springfield and seeing Springfield Prep Charter School, who just opened its doors last year, already making great strides to provide great educational opportunity for kids. It's really exciting. And even this year, I'm back in a district school. I'm at Springfield Public Schools, but myself and the principal at that school both come from charter school backgrounds and have brought a lot of knowledge of what we've seen at charter schools to hopefully try and implement in the public schools. But the building that we're in right now, we're in a giant, it used to be a 1,200 student middle school. We're one little wing in the basement, and it's really heartbreaking to sit on hall duty and see the six classrooms where we're in one wing, you know, like having students learning, sitting in classrooms, seeing, you know, the good learning process take place, and then look down the hallway, walk down the hallway and see, you know, schools that are not serving kids well and kids who are not learning. And so I think even just seeing it in one building is really eye-opening to me. I think there's a lot of work that can, you know, happen in district schools, but I think right now the students in Springfield are being underserved. I don't think it's very, you know, from an equity perspective, they're not all given a fair shot at getting a great education. One other thing that I just also really like about charter schools is that they're held accountable, I think, in ways that it's really hard to sometimes hold big district schools accountable just for sheer volume. You know, charter schools get reviewed every 5 years. Within their first years of opening, they have more oversight. And I think it's nice to see that there's a level of accountability where your doors will get shut if you're not meeting your goals and you're not educating students. I don't think that that's feasible at a district level, especially for a district like Springfield that's serving over 20,000 students. But I think that in my mind, is something that is like needed, and it's a good thing that's in place for charter schools.
Thanks, Mindy. Okay, so thank you for the full report.
Of the 32,000 kids, you said that are
32,000 families.
Okay.
Children.
Well, you said families.
I'm sorry, it's 32,646 children are on the waiting list across the state right now.
How many of them are from the western part of the state, the three county area here?
Yeah, I don't have an exact number of the three county. I know it's probably, I think it's a couple thousand.
Well, I know what we were last year. So last year we had, at Springfield Prep Charter School, we had 107 students, and we had over 200 families on the, 200 students on the wait list.
So I have a question. What do you think makes the difference between a district school and a charter school in terms of the student performance? Because you've dedicated teachers on this, or maybe you don't.
On both sides, yes. No, you do on both, totally on both sides, yeah.
And so, so what's the difference? Class size?
Yeah. I mean, part of it, I think is definitely class size. I think, in my mind, a lot of it's autonomy. So I think when you have a large district, it can be very hard to put systems in place where teachers and administrators feel like they have the power to make decisions, especially when you kind of have to jump through hoops in a lot of ways to get certain things done. And so, I mean, we're experiencing a little bit of that right now, moving from a smaller charter school to a big district school. Getting things done can be really tough if there's a lot of, like, things have always been done a certain way and it's hard to adjust, or, you know, there's different layers of, bureaucracy, and also just like the checks and balances that are in place in big districts, I think can be really tough. And so I think that in my perspective, that's what I've noticed in some of the smaller charter schools that are able to be more responsive to individual students and families, definitely goes a long way.
So it sounds like what you're saying is that a big part of the problem in underperforming schools serving lower income families is school size.
Part of it, yeah. And I think, so that's what they're actually trying to combat in Springfield. So they went from having these 1200 student middle schools, which just sounds crazy to me, to trying to make them smaller. So now they've broken big schools into multiple smaller middle schools, but still realizing that to do a full cultural reset and kind of renorm on what things are happening, it's really even hard to do with 300 students. And so the program that I'm part of is actually, we're only taking over sixth grade at one of the middle schools. So we're revamping at the sixth grade level and then building our way up so we can put systems and structures in place that the sixth graders can learn, and then they can grow and kind of be leaders for the school. So I think, I think size is definitely a factor, especially when you're trying to implement certain systems and structures on a wide scale level.
So what's the average size of the charter schools?
The overall school size? I think it really depends on the charter. So at Excel, each middle school was 224 students, and that's what was built into their charter. But Springfield Prep, for example, will eventually be closer to 400 students because they'll be a K-8. So it all depends on the number of seats they're granted.
And how large is the Newton District School?
Newton District School?
Yeah.
Newton, I know it's a high schools each have, there's two high schools each have about 2,000 students, and that's two high schools, and then their middle schools would feed into that.
So and they, Newton performs fairly well.
Exactly,
right? Yes. Even though they're large schools.
Right, and I think there's definitely different challenges that come with serving a low-income population that you don't see in a higher-income population, like...
the fact that schools are funded with property tax.
That's part of it, yeah, the price per pupil that from each area definitely makes an impact, but I guess I was thinking of more of like the stress factors that come with living in poverty. You don't have enough food on the table, parents are working multiple jobs, those types
of
things.
Right, that's a problem. So charter schools are going to do what for those parents?
So I think in my experience, we've had the ability to be more responsive to students who are struggling with those needs.
Your school,
so
what
when
about
you're
all the other students there,
right,
be left to
the ones that don't get into the charter school, right, and that's why we're trying to get the cap lifted, because we want to have more seats in the charter school.
But you can only have 1% of the total.
Right.
That's up to. So currently 96% of students in the Commonwealth go to district schools, district public schools, so 4% are going to charters. You know, with the cap lift, that number of 4% will go up a little bit. Yes, there's still going to be the case where, you know, most kids are going to traditional public district schools. That is the case. Over time, I would expect policy changes to continue to address, like Amanda's mentioning, what's happening in Springfield with empowerment zones. Look at those big districts that are, you know, have a lot of poverty and a lot of other issues. There's a lot to do to fix that. It's not a there's no panacea. It's not an overnight fix. But again, there's still going to be a majority of students in district schools who will need some sort of intervention for those school districts. Charters, however, are providing another option for that.
And the charter school selection process, is that basically a lottery?
Yes. There's a lottery after the seats are filled. So, for example...
Lottery after the seats?
Yes. So there's only a lottery. I mean, essentially, if there's 224 seats available in a charter school and only 223 apply, those kids are automatically enrolled in the school and then they choose to go. If there are more applicants for the number of seats actually available in the school, that's when a lottery kicks in, and then that is a randomized, open, blind public lottery.
So it's a public school. You're required to administer and deal with special needs.
Yes, students.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So there's absolutely no screening or filtering.
That's
no,
absolutely
not
correct.
At all. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that's one of the things that I know. I've heard the Mass Teachers Association say, you know, Springfield Public Schools had a higher percentage of special ed students, a higher percentage of English language learners and whatnot. And this charter school that I was at, we actually had a higher percentage of special ed students and ELL students. So I think part of that oversight of charter schools is making sure that the process is being very fair and is unbiased. And so I think that that's one thing the state definitely, I mean, you get a lot of questions about that when they're interviewing you about the school, about like your progress, like what is your application process like? What is like, are you screening out students? What did you do to make sure that you were recruiting students of all different needs?
Are the faculty of charter schools members of the union?
There's only one charter school in all Massachusetts that's unionized, and it's on the Cape. Charters are able to be unionized. The MTA could go in tomorrow and try to unionize, to organize within charter schools. I've talked to them about that, and you know they've chosen not to, but they have the absolute right to do so. But most charter public schools in Massachusetts, all but one, are not unionized.
One of the things that strikes me about the comparisons with the new, and in thinking about education and realizing that it's not cookie cutter, a great school for one student, or one student's great school, does not necessarily mean it's a great school for another student.
Yeah.
Personalities, family issues, goals in life, variety of factors. And when you talk about the Newtons of the world, as great a school as the Newton Public Schools provide, they still have, and I certainly couldn't quote the data on it, they still have a large number of students who choose to pay for private school.
Sure.
And they're choosing to go to a private school because the Newton Public Schools, strong schools, aren't giving those students, or their families decide that those schools aren't giving their children the education that works best for those students. And the thing that I always get concerned about is that the lower income students don't have that option because they can't afford the private schools. And if their parents, in the same way that a Newton family or a Wellesley or any high-income community, in the same way that they make the decision, I'm going to find a better place for my child, nothing against the place they came from,
sure,
that option doesn't exist. So, you know, there are a lot of amazing teachers and amazing students in the Springfield Public Schools.
Yes, there are.
Putnam Tech is, if you walk through that school, it is very cool. I mean, it is really cool.
Yeah.
Commerce, a little bit more of a traditional school, but it's still a really good school. But it doesn't work for everybody. And this provides an opportunity to give people a choice that they're frustrated if they don't meet. And the thing I like also is that if a school isn't performing charter, they'll shut it down, as they should, and they have.
28 schools have been shut down since charters were first authorized in 1995.
And that's not an indictment. That's not an indictment on charters. That's just the reality. So I guess I just wanted to say that, but my question to you guys
is what about the students who, the special ed students, who go to a, they choose to go to, I don't care what school it is, could be any of the charter schools. Mm-hmm. One of the things you hear a lot is that they left the school because the school wasn't meeting their needs because they didn't have the capacity to satisfy certain special education needs. Mm-hmm. And I'm struck by that because that's also the case in district schools. We send students to other districts because we don't have that, and they send them to us because they don't have, you know, they're set up for different things. And I guess I'm wondering, what happens in a charter school when the charter school is not meeting the needs of the special education student? What?
I mean, I think in my experience, I've seen some really innovative things happen around students with special needs. For example, at Excel in Boston, we had a student come in, and we were, it was our second year that school is open, very small staff, and who clearly needed a separate classroom placement because cognitively was low and behind grade level. And so the school, you know, worked to, we hired a whole separate teacher to kind of to work with him, and that program grew as the charter school grew to house more students who needed that. So in my experience, I think everyone I've worked with has been really thoughtful around trying to keep all of the students that we can serve well in the building. I think there are there's definitely limitations, like you're talking about the charter school space, just like district school space, around either funding or resources, different resources. So we had a student who got in off of the, at Springfield Prep, who got in during the lottery, but was in more of a life skills class. So had kind of a full-time aide, a full-time paraprofessional, different things like that, was learning more about, you know, how to budget and grocery shop and different things like that. And it wasn't, and it was the parent came in and met with us, and we were willing to build a program around them, but the parent ultimately decided that it could be best served through Springfield Public Schools. So I think it really just is one of those things that comes down to, you know, as far as I've seen it, charter schools, you know, the people at charter schools are bending over backwards to try and make it work, but it's ultimately a conversation between the school and the parent about, you know, is this really, are we really going to be able to provide everything that they need, or can it be better done somewhere else?
My last question, and we're probably going to have to move on. One of the things you talked about was the fact that your principal and you come from charters, and that you've brought with you some of the experiences and lessons learned, positive and negative, I'm sure.
Yes.
How has that information been embraced? Because one of the criticisms that I hear about charter schools all the time is that they don't share.
Yeah.
And that was part of the mandate,
yeah,
originally designed for charters. And I'm sympathetic to that argument, but there's always two sides. So I'm curious how you share that information, whether that information has been well received by the school you're in, and whether the information has then ultimately been shared with other schools in the Springfield School District, not just yours.
Yeah. I think the biggest thing, like right off the bat, so we're only a month into the school year, that I think we both brought to the table is this idea of having systems and structures in place. For things like school operations are a very big deal at charter schools. That's been my role for the last four years now at schools, is thinking through how do kids walk through hallways the right way? How do we implement a consistent behavior system throughout all the classes? How do we do, we just did computerized testing. What's the logistical plan around computerized testing? So I think charter schools in a lot of ways take kind of a more a business approach to thinking through how transitions and different things happen during the day. So we have, like I said, when you walk through our little hallway in the bottom in the basement, and you see, and then you walk through other areas of the school, you see a very stark difference in the, I would say, the tone of the air of the space. So our tone tends to be a little bit more calmer. Kids know where they're doing and know where to go. They know what's expected of them, and you walk to different areas, and it's not so much. So we've definitely. There hasn't been any wide-scale sharing of doing a professional development or different things like that, but there's definitely been internal sharing with folks at the other middle schools around testing, around how are you getting the kids to walk in a straight silent line like that? So there's been that more informal discussion. I do think that part of the aim behind the empowerment zone, bringing in, you know, people with new visions for these middle schools, is that ideas will come up that other schools can adopt. But I know that part of what they're trying to do is also not have a cookie cutter version and say this is what it needs to look like, for the sole reason that different neighborhoods, different schools need different things.
But just one last question. I have, how many charter schools are in low income districts?
I mean, it's a great question. There are 81 charter schools in Massachusetts. I can give you this number, I'm happy to. Off the top of my head, it's about 80%, I believe, are absolutely low income districts.
60.
Yeah, exactly. It's quite a high number. I don't think I even have that in front of me, but I don't think I do. That's a great question, though.
I'm afraid we're out of time, okay. But I'd like to thank you guys for coming in and sharing with us and balancing the other side.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm sure there are others.
Well, yeah.
There's yes or no on the ballot. That's what makes this a yes or no. But again, there are many other approaches to education. We're not pretending.
There's no, I'll think about it later.
Yeah. What's that?
There's no, I'll think about it later on the ballot.
You can't leave a blank, but I don't know what that means. It just doesn't get counted. So.
If anyone wants to come visit, come see Springfield.
Well, I might come see Springfield. I might be working in the Springfield school system.
Oh, really?
Nice.
As a consultant.
Oh, very cool.
I've worked at Putnam already.
Oh, very cool.
So you've been there.
Yeah, it's amazing.
What do you consult on?
We consult on civic participation.
Oh, very
social
cool.
Studies.
Makes sense. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. And
well, that's not my day job. That's just an extra thing.
Very cool.
I was a teacher for years in the Long Meadow.
Yeah, great. Yeah.
System. But, so,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I leave Paris?
Sure. That'd be great.
Thank you.
Thank
you, guys. Very nice to meet you. Shane. Nice to meet you.
Paul. Shane.
Shane.
Pleasure.
Nice to meet you. Jonathan, pleasure.
Thank you.
Very nice to meet you. Thank you for your help. Thank you, guys. Have a good
thanks.
Night.
Thanks to both of you guys.
All right. So now it looks like it's executive session time. All right.